for having me.
Thank you for coming. First time I ever saw you was in Caroline or Change at the Public Theater. Blown away. Then I saw you in London in Caroline or Change. Blown away. Different. You were different in some way.
Okay.
And I think you said in some interview that when you first did Caroline or Change, everything that was happening in your life was so heavy and you were struggling and you brought that to the part. Then when you got to London, things were a little bit lighter. And you you looked like you never... And you went to some person named Annette.
Oh, Annette Verspeek.
Verspeek, who taught you, gave you a technique.
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about what that was and what was different?
Well, I'll say one thing about doing it in New York. I've always been just, my thing is to show up and get out of the way. Try to get out of the way. Like, rehearsal is a time to make decisions. And then when you're playing the play, you have to get out of the way. And they felt, they were, and so I was able to do the show very easily. And never ever took a script home. It just was so well written that the material spoke to me. And they wanted me to work with this voice coach. I'm not naming any names. And so I like to learn. And so I was working with a coach who specializes in people who are having problems. But I wasn't having problems. So I started doing her techniques. And then I got problems. And so...
Do you want to say what the technique was?
Well, there was hundreds of different ones, but they were for people who had problems. But I'm thinking, well, they're sending me and they're paying for me to work with this person. I should be trying all these techniques. So I'm trying all these techniques, and then suddenly I forgot how to do what I had been doing naturally. And so then I started having lots of vocal problems. But I just felt like the show is about more than that, so I kept showing up to do the show, even when I had no voice at all. By the time I got to go to London, I was so freaked out about, would I have a voice, would I have a voice, would I have a voice? And Anna Mehta, she just was this beautiful spirit, and what she was able to show me was that in my fear that I wouldn't have a voice, I had developed all these physical tensions. And so a lot of what she worked with me on was that I had to be Caroline without having Caroline's physicality. So I had to learn how to relax my body so that I could sing, because somehow over time, with the fear of not having a voice and doing this role, I had adopted all these physical things that were constricting my voice.
Interesting. Wow. The moment when you're speaking as Caroline, or anyone, and then you go into song, that transition, you're talking, and then you go into singing. Can you say anything about that transition? Is it, do you think about it, or is it just an extension of an intention, or?
I think it's an extension of an intention. For me, a song is a monologue, and I don't think about it in any way other than as a monologue. When I'm working with students, always I'm like, what's the story? Who are you talking to? What are they doing while you're saying the song? Because I need to see a whole story happen in the course of the song. And if there's a refrain, then every time you do that refrain, something has to be different about it because something has changed in the room with whomever you're speaking with. So that, to me, is the key to great musical theater, when you can take a piece of music and you turn it into a monologue, a story. I think someone who's really great doing that with pop music is a woman named Barb Younger. If you can ever see Barb Younger, she's a British performer, but she takes pop songs and she is telling great stories.
But you talk about, it's like a monologue, but I remember you also singing, and I thought her connection with the audience was so intimate. She knew who these people were. Do you know who those, do you give the audience an identity?
I don't think I think about the audience. As I said, I really try to get out of the way. And with Caroline, I really felt like I was coming, showing up, and if I died in any show, that was fine. Like, I really showed up, like, I'm a little older. I'm like, you know, I can't die tonight. But so with Caroline, I was like, okay, we're going to go, and we're going to just empty everything out, and we may die tonight on this stage.
That's very interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the audience is always there. They're the scene.
Very different. Very different New York audience, oh, Caroline, and London, right?
Very different.
What's the main difference between that audience?
Well, I'm going to say that Los Angeles was the best audience.
Really?
Los Angeles.
Did you do it at the taper?
We did it at the
Amundsen. Yeah.
So we did it in the big house at the Amundsen. Oh. And I don't know, but they laughed like it was a sitcom. And then they went in deep with us. Oh. And they loved it in Los Angeles.
I think they're so starved there for good stuff.
Well, they ate it up, yeah. And it was a thrill to play for them. London, they understand class, so the play was very familiar to them. And London is a place where the theater is so highly respected that the paperboy knows the theater. Everybody goes to the theater. So there was this sense of, yes, okay, this is our lives. Oh, you Americans have the same thing we have.
Yeah. You're right about London. I played in London. I remember somebody saying, "Are you an actor then?" And I said, "Yes." And they said, "Wasn't that wonderful?" Instead of, what are you in?"
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly.
All right. So I've seen you and Caroline are Change here in London, Milk Like Sugar, with our own graduate, Adrian Seymour, who's not here right now.
Yes.
But Adrian's the graduate.
Yes, I know. Oh, I know.
Adrian, right. And Rashida speaking. If you didn't see it, I'm so sorry. Is there a chance it's coming back?
WNET filmed it, so okay. It will broadcast 4 times on the local PBS station. I don't know when, but it will.
And then I saw you a couple of nights ago in Nurse Jackie as Charlene, who's about to put her mommy, Leslie Uggams, into a nursing home. Why are you doing that?
Because I'm tired. I'm tired.
I was thinking now, if I were playing that part, as I always think, if I were playing that part, how would I find it in myself to be able to do that to that nice lady?
Yeah. I think it would be hard for me as a person to do that, but it's a comedy. It was funny.
Do you like working on camera? What do you want from a camera director that's very important for you when you're working in front of a camera?
Well, I just had the privilege of working with Ava DuVernay. And I've never had an experience like that in my life. Well, first of all, she's just a goddess. She is so open, so generous, that one time I had just come off spraining my ankle, and I was wearing a boot. And I was unaware, but all of a sudden, she rushed towards me, and she was on the floor, on her knees, tying my shoe, because it had come untied. And I was like, whoa. She knows what she wants. Mm. She gets it really fast. Mm. She talks to everybody like they're equals. Mm. She talks to the extras like they're equals. Mm. She uses indirect lighting. She has hair and makeup tests beforehand, so you look good. I've never had a hair and makeup test in my life. And I'd look good. You know, I saw some of the dailies when I was doing ADR. And she shoots it quick. She knows what she wants. And so she comes and she's having a very... She's not tense. This is easy for her. And so she comes and she has this, you know, very, you know, me to you conversation. And she's like, oh, you're ready. Okay, I'm going to change it. We're going to do your close up now because you're ready. You're ready now. Okay, we shoot your close up now.
Yeah. Do you remember the first time you worked in front of a camera and they said, this is rehearsal for camera, please? I remember when I first heard that and I thought, what do you mean rehearsal for camera?
Right.
Well, what about us?
Right. That would have probably been for me on soap operas.
Was that All My Children or the one before?
As the World Turns.
As the World Turns. Then you went All My Children?
Yes.
And what's the biggest challenge of working on a soap, aside from learning lines every night?
I think soap operas are pretty fun. I mean, there aren't that many left, but it was this opportunity to, you know, it's sort of high theater, but there's a camera there, so you get to set off little explosions everywhere. And
what do you mean by that?
Well, you know, it's kind of a talking heads medium. You know, so you've got to make things very interesting and exciting so you can be, you kind of get into high comedy at sometimes points in soap operas, because other than that, it could be kind of boring.
Because of the writing.
Well, the writing is very repetitive. They're designed so that you can only watch them 2 times a week and still keep up with story. So you're saying things over and over so that if they didn't watch yesterday or the day before, they can come in today and know where the story is.
Do you know the expression, the egg?
No.
This is, now maybe this isn't, but this is what I was told when I did a
show. Oh yeah, the egg, when you get your egg, the egg, that's the last shot.
Tell them what.
So in soap operas, you know, the last shot that has the stinger, we used to call that the egg. Like, you're the person who's left to have some face that tells everybody what to be coming back for, the cliffhanger moment.
Right. Did you ever have a problem with that?
No, it's actually fun.
Okay. Oh, I wish I'd had that kind of attitude. it wasn't fun for me. Well, first of all, they have a red light that went off. You know, when
the red light, right? You only act when the red light's on.
Because the red light went on, and they said, come on. And I said, there's a red light on. To that means stop to me. I kept waiting. They said, come on.
No. The red light is cameras rolling on you, so don't act until then, because it's not being filmed.
Oh, God. Okay, now let me get back to Rashida speaking, which you were fantastic. You and Diane Wiest had scenes together. They were just crackling, everybody in it. But I remember your entrance. Now, wasn't there a glass door?
Yes.
Okay, so we got to see you waiting just before you came to work.
Yes.
This is a woman who's working in a white office for a white doctor and another person who's white, who's, what do you call her, the assistant? No, she was
the last time I was at work, we were both secretaries.
Right.
But now when I return, something's, I discover in the scene that she is now my boss and she's gotten a raise.
But she doesn't, you don't know this.
Not when I come in, no.
Okay, but can you take me from your dressing room to that door, what your preparation was? Or do you know?
Usually I just, you know, go backstage at places and then I would listen to Diane, who is different every night, and I would be like, oh my God, she's doing that today? Oh, yes. I gotta meet that. She's such alive and so brilliant, and she's just channeling. I don't even know that she knows what she's doing. She's not making decisions. She is just alive, and I would just be listening off stage to go, okay, that's the play we're doing tonight. Okay, let me go there and do that.
Yes.
And then my character, for 10 minutes, the two characters on stage talk about what an awful person I am. And then I make an entrance.
And she makes an entrance. Such a setup.
Right. I'm set up to be the bad guy. And so I decided that I wanted to have like mirror shades. And the doctor has just said, his last line is, she's late, isn't she? Mm. Well, after a week's absence, you'd think she'd be early. Mm-hmm. And my Diane said, well, she's got 30 seconds. And so when he walks off saying she should have been early, I'm walking to the door and looking at my watch to come in at exactly the moment that I'm due.
That's right. It was such a powerful entrance. I'm thinking, you know, before you hit the stage, what's going on? What, you know?
Yeah, I'm just listening to Diane and going,
well, that's it.
Look at what she is doing today. Okay, I got to try to come to that.
And you did. And then you came on. I remember thinking, you were like a panther or something, sniffing something was in the air. You didn't, something was different.
Mm-hmm.
It was just fantastic.
Yeah. So, I mean, the play really deals a lot with microaggressions. And one of the things that, there are studies coming out every day now, that these microaggressions are killing millions of non-white people every year. It's not just getting shot by a police officer, but walking around in spaces where your point of view is not acknowledged, where you're treated as if you are the person bringing race into the room, and so you're the problem. Dr. Kimberly Crenshaw talked about the fact that for peoples who are of color, often the dominant culture in the workplace, and the workplace, she said, is not a neutral space. It's a white, masculine, hetero space. Mm-hmm. And so the further away you are from white, masculine, and hetero, the more difficult it is for you to fit in. Mm-hmm. And so she said, what happens for people who are, anybody who doesn't fit that specific normative, the person who is in charge only sees, recognizes, notes stereotype conforming behavior. So in the case of Jacqueline, you don't know, I'm going to be telling you stuff that you didn't see, but Jacqueline is perhaps a little efficient with an older woman as a patient. So she's written down as being rude. Jacqueline has patterns that are Afrocentric. You know, so her HR report would say she was rude and she doesn't dress appropriately. Mm-hmm. And she, she's trying to make the office like her home because she's bringing all these plants in. Mm-hmm. And She said, so that would be what an HR report said. What an HR report would not say, because the boss would not recognize any non-stereotype conforming behavior, it would not say that I type like 100 words a minute,
right,
that my desk is immaculate, mm-hmm, that I get incredible amounts of work done. So that's what, mm-hmm, you know, people are up against when they go into this environment. In fact, the new group has just hired its first Black employees in 20 years in the last month.
Wow.
And I was hanging out with some people there, and they were talking about how this one South African woman who was the assistant director on her play, she had just been hired, and how she was getting on their nerves, her emails, and how they used to like her, but now she was really annoying. And I was like, okay, now, so I hope you all know that this is your fault and your problem. Mm-hmm. It's not her. She's coming in and doing a job at a level that she has to do, where you all are used to being casual. You get it done when you want to get it done. She doesn't have jobs like that. Mm-hmm. She doesn't get hired when she does that. So now you're feeling upset with her because she's holding you to the task of what you hired her to do. Mm-hmm. So I hope all of you will look at yourself every time you're getting annoyed at her and know that it's really that she's doing what the job is, and you all have gotten into a habit where you don't have to do that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. you started when you were 14 years old?
Yeah, professionally.
What effect did it have on you starting so young?
I think it was a great escape for me. I sort of didn't fit in, and so I had this other place that I could go to where I did fit in. I was studying at the St. Nicholas Theater Company when I was 15, and William H. Macy was my acting teacher. And John Mahoney was taking his first acting class, so we were in class together. And I was the youngest person there. So it was a space where I fit in better. I fit in better with adults.
Yeah. I was going to ask you about your education. Goodman Theater for Young People, mm-hmm, Columbia College in Chicago, Carnegie Mellon Music Theater Program, California Western School of Law. Mm-hmm. You're an attorney?
I'm not an attorney. I did not finish law school. And you don't have...
But you play.
You don't have
attorney.
My film certificate on there, do you?
No, I don't, attorney Livia Fry today. But no, I don't. I'm so sorry. Next time. But so you went to law school.
I did.
Now, why did you go to law school?
I went to law school because I was having, by that point, I'd had some very difficult times in my own life, and I'd started an organization to help women in custody situations. Mm. And so people kept saying, you need to go to law school. You need to go to law school. And I was like, yeah, but I haven't finished college yet, and I can't do 7 more years of school. But as it worked out, I was able to finish my undergrad degree very quickly, and Cal Western was a 2-year law program, and they made me an offer that was great. And I was in law school, and I was doing Play On at the Old Globe simultaneously, and pregnant with my third child.
Whoa. Wow, okay. Now, did that help you playing a lawyer in All My Children? That must. Was that after All My Children when you played the lawyer?
It was simultaneous.
Oh, okay.
It was simultaneous.
Fed in some way.
Yeah, yeah. I just happened to have a knack for the law. I don't know how to describe that, but law school was not going to work out for me because this idea of blind grading. Like, that was ridiculous to me. How is it going to be blind grading? When you're writing your essays, because that's all you're writing in a law class, is you're writing arguments. Mm-hmm. And voice is what makes a writer. So it was just clear to me, my teachers are always going to know who I am because they're going to know how I argue.
Yeah.
So that was just kind of ridiculous to me. And law school felt like a form of intense brainwashing. And I would watch students every day, you know, forget their common sense. Mm-hmm.
Is there anything in those schools that I mentioned, and also you studied with Bill Esper?
Mm-hmm.
Any of those, is there a particular lesson you learned that you can share with us from any of those teaching learning experiences? And
I think I still go back to my elementary school teacher is who got me at the St. Nicholas Theater, and it's the same technique. We were studying Stanislavski and then Meisner, and it's living truthfully and fully in imaginary circumstances. A lot of the directors coming out of these grad school programs, they you know, come in and they want to do exercises, and they want to know who is your character, and bring in a picture of your character. And I always bring in my headshot because I'm my character.
It.
Okay.
That's okay. It. We teach a collab course here, Collaboration 1 and 2.
Okay.
Okay, and it's writers, directors, and actors. We teach them how to work together.
Okay.
What was your best collaborative experience to date?
Well, Diane Wiest would be my best collaborative experience to date. I'm lucky because I've predominantly done new works for 30 years. Mm-hmm. So I've gotten to be in the room with some of the greatest playwrights and directors of my time. I got to work with Arthur Miller on a play that he'd written about Marilyn, and I got to play Marilyn.
What was that called?
I don't even remember.
Oh, wow. That I don't even remember
what it was called. I know my resume, I've had to cut off about 10, 15 years of it.
Yeah. He was alive then.
Oh, yeah. No, he was there.
Now, they tell me that the first day of rehearsal, that he reads the play out loud to everybody. Do you remember that?
He did not do that. He did not do that. But, right. Just getting to be with Arthur Miller or Tony Kushner or Larry Kramer or Michael John Lacusa and George C. Wolfe.
Yeah.
My best collaboration today, I would say that there was something about Carolina Change that was just an incredible thing for all of us. And to be in the room with Tony Kushner and be able to say, Tony, I think my character needs this. And for him to go, oh, okay, let me go work about on that, you know? So it's sort of odd, like sometimes I'm with new playwrights and they're like, you can't tell them anything. And I'm like, if Tony Kushner can take a note from me, you can take a note from me.
Right. Absolutely. Do you like the playwright to be in the room?
It depends on the playwright.
Yeah.
It really depends on the playwright. I'm not going to name names here. I worked with a playwright and director once, and I don't know what their dynamic was, but they treated us as actors like we were naughty stepchildren. And they were, and so we would sit and we would do table work, and no matter what question we asked, they would tell us we were wrong and that this was on the page. And so after a few days of that, we went to stage management and said, we're not doing any more table work. If they know everything and there's no questions we can ask, then they should just tell us what to do on our feet. And so, we'd get up on our feet and we'd do what they asked, and it didn't make sense, and they weren't being respectful enough of our process to know that it has to make sense because we have to believe it to do it. And then one day, I remember I had just decided I was leaving because it was just too painful. Mm-hmm. And we came in that day and our director said to us, now so-and-so, who was some famous somebody, read the play and thought it was just brilliant and they couldn't sleep and it was wonderful. And so if you guys don't understand it, that's your insecurity and negativity. Wow. Now don't share that with one another. Just do it because you have to trust that we know it works. And if you have anything that you don't feel, that you feel isn't working, just know it works and come to us. Don't talk amongst each other. And I remember I thought, let me get my negativity out of your room. And so I went to them and I said, you know what? I'm going to have to leave. I'm giving you my notice, but I will stay in the room until you replace me. You don't need to let anybody know that I've left. I'm going to just show up and do the work every day. But they were so, this is the level of arrogance, was that they came into the room and said, well, Tonya's going to be leaving our rooms and we wish her well and we wish ourselves well. And at the end of the day, everybody quit and that show never happened.
Oh, that's great. You come to the first day of rehearsal in the theater. You come to the first day of rehearsal. What work have you already done?
It depends on the play. Mm-hmm. I like research. So if there's some sort of historic or something, I've done a lot of research. I don't like to come with my lines learned, though I'm reading a Mariah Aiken book, and she's making a very convincing argument for why, at least when you're dealing with the classics, coming with the language already learned might be a good thing. But in general, that's not what I'm working with. I'm generally working with the new plays. And I come to rehearsal going, this play that I'm working on is not going to be the play that we end up putting on stage. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't make sense to learn these lines. They're not going to be these lines.
Do you ever, what happens if you are not connecting with an actor? Do you?
There's not really anything you can do. There's not much you can do about that.
Uta Hagen once said to David Hyde Pierce when he did something on stage, you're not going to do that, are you?
Really? It was Uta Hagen who said that.
Oh, she, my. They had a huge argument.
Wow.
And they stomped out of the stage. This was in L.A. And they got to the parking lot, arguing. Well, you don't respect me. I do respect you, he said. And he said when they got to the car, they had fallen in love.
Huh. That's interesting.
Maybe it is. I'm not
That's
sure.
interesting. Well, I feel like, you know, I've had actors say to me, oh, when you do that, I go dry.
Oh, my God.
And I think, well, that's an interesting problem you have to solve. You know,
that's a wonderful.
Yeah,
an interesting problem.
It's like not my job to tell other actors what to do. I think that that's sort of etiquette in the theater, unless you have a relationship with an actor. And because they respect you, they're like, hey, if you see anything or if you got any ideas for me, let me know.
Isn't that nice?
And that's a rarity, you know, that you might have with somebody who you just go, I really respect you. You got anything for me? And I certainly felt that way about Diane. You know, anything you can tell me how to get another laugh?
Yeah.
How do I do it?
Yeah. Yeah. What part was emotionally really hard for you to reach?
In what?
In anything that was very far from you.
I can't really think of one. I just have been really fortunate to be cast in things that I knew. If it wasn't close to me, I knew somebody who was like that. I mean,
okay.
I love meeting people, and I have a way of just sitting down with people and paying attention to them so that they tell me their whole life stories. So I have a lot of stories and people in my head because I just, you know, travel around the world and sit down and listen to people.
Mm-hmm. That's wonderful. Did you ever, this is probably repetitive, but did you ever play a part where you couldn't shake it?
Rashida speaking. I guess I would say I'm still recovering from Rashida
really?
Speaking.
Because
Because when you're a person of color in this culture, you have to know everything about white people and they don't have to know anything about you. And so you have a very broad perspective that they don't have. Because they don't think it's valuable. Because they live in a world where there are TV shows where there are no people of color in them, which sends a symbolic message that color is valueless, that you can have a great life with no color in it. And so the sort of internalized dominance of that becomes difficult to have a conversation with because you're essentially having a conversation with someone who perceives themselves as superior to you, but who actually is far less educated than you. And so how do you speak to that? My friend George C. Wolfe said, you have to talk to who people think they are, not to who they really are.
Oh, that's interesting.
But that's very difficult to do when, you know, I'm in a play where I'm the only black person in the room. I happen to be a black person from the west and south sides of Chicago, and that's what the playwright has written. And I'm clear that he doesn't know what the play is that he wrote. And he doesn't know who a black woman is from the west or south side of Chicago. The language is wrong, the behavior is wrong. And yet you're in the room to collaborate and you're hoping that that's why he's in the room. So you can collaborate and you can say, hey, you know, this is really how my culture does it, or this is how my culture does it. And they're gonna go, oh, great. You know, I wouldn't know that. Thank you for helping me. Let me, you know, sort that out. But what I met with in that room was, no, you're wrong, you're wrong. No, this is who this character is, and this is, and so it was this sort of crazy making experience of coming to work every day and having people tell me what this play was going to be when I knew what this play was going to be. I knew how this play was going to be perceived, and I was working with people who kind of just didn't know. And so therefore I didn't have any support. They couldn't support me because they didn't know what I was going to have to go through. And so working on the play and doing the play were kind of like living the play all the time, and it was pretty depressing for both Diane and I.
Oh, wow. Well, what was happening on stage? Well, that was all happening. It was really happening. Happening.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, wow. What else? Jelly's Last Jam, which I wish I'd seen. Oh, I wish I'd seen it. I don't know where I was. You won a Tony. And my question is, you said something about that's when you found out you were a good actor?
I say I earned my stripes on that one because I was fired from that show probably a good 10 times. And when I was cast as Jelly at that particular point in my career, I had only ever played ingenues. And I got hired on a Saturday to go to Los Angeles on a Sunday, and I'd never read a script.
Wow.
I'd only read like this one scene. Mm-hmm. And then when I read the script on the plane, I was like, oh my God, this is a woman. I've never played a woman. This is a woman like my mother and my grandmother and my great-grandmother. Oh my God. And I was walking into a room where this team had already worked together on this show for several years. The girl who had played the part in the previous renditions was now in the ensemble. So I was walking into a difficult room and faced with what excited me to be, you know, the deepest part I'd ever get to play. And I was terrified to do anything. So I would be at home and I'd be knowing what I wanted to do, but I would get to rehearsal and I would do nothing. And George C. Wolfe is a very spiritual guy. And we talked about it maybe 10 years after the fact. And he said that we were going to have a run through. And what I had decided for myself is I had all these ideas. And I was so excited about them, but I really feared that if I showed them and somebody stopped me, that it would shut me down and I would just not be able to. And I said, if I can just get to the run through where I know I won't be stopped, and then I'll know if all this stuff that's been coming to me works. So George, the night before the run through, Mary Bond Davis was having a cabaret. And George said that he had already decided he was going to fire me. But our cars showed up at the parking lot at the exact same time. And so he felt that was a sign that he should give me another chance. And so we got there the next day and I did the run through and I did all the things that I'd been dreaming about and excited about at home. And the room was... they were shocked because basically pretty much everybody had decided I was just useless. And now they were kind of pissed because it was like, oh shit, you gonna do that? So.
You're gonna do that.
Right, so, it was very tense. And I was just always now getting notes and being criticized, and I got fired several times.
And wow, so did you, well, you quit too. You both have been fired and you quit.
Quit shows? Yeah. I've quit shows and I've been fired from shows, yeah.
Good for you. Okay, what's the worst audition you ever had? Do you remember auditioning?
Oh my God, I have so many bad auditions.
To the actors about auditioning? Is there
I have so many bad auditions. I think that the sort of challenge is like when you get to where I am in my career, in the theater, I don't audition very much.
So you need to.
You get out of the habit of auditioning, and auditioning is just a skill that you have to keep going. You have to keep that going. You have to be able to be the director for yourself and set up that whole scene. That means like whatever the blocking, whatever you think that scene is. And I will say that when I auditioned for the piano lesson for Lloyd Richards, and I directed myself. And when I actually did the play, and it wasn't the first time they were doing the play, I was happy to see that what I had chosen as an actor at home was actually the blocking he had already designed for this character. So you have to do all of that, to me, when you go in and you do an audition for a play. You have to direct the play, direct the scene, and do the scene as if you were doing the scene
in
the play.
Know where your place is,
know where
your space
you are, and know what that other person is doing and saying, and live it out.
And be able to take direction if the director's in the room.
Right. Obviously. And make a choice, and make a really strong choice. It might not be the right choice. I actually think it's better to make a choice that you think they wouldn't make and make it strong, you know, rather than coming in and being what you think they're looking for.
Oh, right.
I think it's better to come in and make a choice that excites you so that then they see you at your best and at your most, you know, activated, and then they can decide to direct you, because directors want to feel like they have a part in your work, like they can take credit for getting you somewhere. And if you come in with it, then they're like, oh, I can't put my name on that. You know, I once had a friend not hire Donna Murphy because he said she was just so perfect.
Oh, so you're right. So he wouldn't have a hand in it.
Yeah, he wouldn't have a hand in
credit.
It. Yeah, so he didn't hire her.
Do you like to improvise?
I think that living truthfully and fully in imaginary circumstances is improvising. The lines are the same, the blocking is the same, but if you came to see Rashida, every night it was a different show.
Yeah, I'm sure.
It was a different
Do
show.
Do you have an underneath text?
Night.
There's the text that's written, And then do you have an underneath text that you... Mandy Patinkin was here last month, and he said he always has an underneath text going on.
Yeah, Mandy has an inner life that is so compelling. Yeah. I mean, I watch him on TV, and I had the pleasure of doing Wild Party with him.
Yeah,
his inner life, I would like to have an inner life like Mandy.
Mandy's
inner life is, you just look in his eyes, and there's always a whole bunch going on. You know, for Rashida speaking, the script was something very specific, mm-hmm. and the lines themselves were really quite nasty, and so Diane and I had decided that it was important to us to create a friendship that wasn't on the page, and that what we wanted an audience to walk away with was, gosh, there was a friendship that didn't happen, and to feel the loss of that. So
did you work together alone?
We did not.
But you talked together?
We did not.
You did not need to.
We did not work together. We didn't have dinner together. We didn't have drinks together. Mm-hmm. We just showed up and did the work together, and we were just with each other, mm-hmm. and just present. And it was this beautiful, beautiful dance. And each of us mm-hmm. would go different places, and we'd each sort of, some days we'd be like playing games with each other, like, I'm going to do this. I'm like, well, I'm going to do this. And there would be this, yeah. oh, okay. And it was just exciting. It was exciting.
That's the best.
It was exciting.
you said something, Tonya, you said something when you're working in front of television. Now, maybe you just meant soap. I don't know. If you don't give them everything in the first read, they'll fire you. That when you're reading it for the first time,
camera,
you better come out with your performance right away, not just read it. Not so in the theater.
Right, not when so in the theater, but
you don't have any
in
time.
Like, you know, when they have those read-throughs or
yeah.
something, yeah, they're looking for what it's going to be, because they can recast before they start shooting. you got to give it to them.
You have something. Do you have any problem doing dolly shots, you know, when you're walking in there, the camera's in front of you, and you've got to walk down a hallway?
No.
Oh, okay. I was going to say, how do you manage to keep your focus? That's my problem.
Oh, well, usually you're talking to somebody.
Yeah,
so
but they're in front of you going this way. You know, they're right in front of you with the camera.
Yeah, but they're going right smoothly.
Yes.
And so you just get to, like, live your life.
I had the hardest time. I kept trying to look at the camera. finding the appetite to say the words. What's the main difference in your process when you're doing A Winter's Tale or Katori Hall's or Hurt Village? It's a different words, different...
I have to say, I'm still very intimidated by Shakespeare. Very intimidated by it. But as I said, reading this book by Mariah Aiken, she's convinced me I meant to do that language.
Absolutely.
I love the language, but
absolutely.
I'm still very intimidated. And I look forward to working with her and having her get me comfortable. Because actually, literally, I took a Shakespeare class and I just wept. Because I just found, because when I see people do something really great, and I know I'm not there, it's very depressing to me. And I've worked with some great Shakespearean actors, and I'm like, I'm not there. You know, I'm like a little kiddie Shakespeare actor. Oh, they have turned it into a whole nother thing. Dakin Matthews, Carson Elrod, Lucas Caleb Rooney, Andre Holland, Kristen Connolly, some of the people that I did the last Shakespeare with. These people are just masters with that language. That I don't have the knowledge, I don't have the education to do that yet.
The language, because you've got the emotional life. Usually what's missing in Shakespeare is the emotional life. You hear the language, but that's all you hear.
Yeah, I agree with you. A Dakin Matthews, I mean, I bought all of his books. He has books on pronouns, like how to use a pronoun and when a pronoun is important. Or I spent some time working with Lisa Volpe, who took me back to the first folio to say, look, Shakespeare's saying mother. The character's called the mother here. That's because mm-hmm. Shakespeare's letting you know that in this scene, that's who you're being, much in the same way that Brecht does, mm-hmm. you know? Mm. Dakin Matthews.
Do you have a mentor?
I do. I would say that it's my elementary school teacher, Harris Goldenberg, who really kept me in this and got me my first agent and got me at the St. Nicholas Theater, and who convinced me to not go to Puerto Rico over my freshman break at Carnegie Mellon and go to an open call for Merrily We Roll Along, which was my first Broadway show.
Oh, wow. Wow. Oh, Stephen Sondheim. Actorpreneur attitude.
Yes.
You teach a course called Actorpreneur attitude. What's that course about?
I wrote a book called Get Over Yourself, How to Drop the Drama and Claim the Life You Deserve.
Oh, God, I love that title.
And
say that title one more time.
Get Over Yourself.
Yeah.
How to Drop the Drama and Claim the Life You Deserve. And I'm running for equity counsel right now. Vote for me, Peter.
Oh, yes.
And I, you know, when I gave my speech for the national meeting, it was, I could tell that it made people so uncomfortable. But I feel like actors have been the beggars and the, you know, the lowest of the low. And it is really time for us to change that culture, and we have to begin to change that inside of ourselves. And so that's what I want to get on council to do. More than any contract, I want to begin to figure out how do we change our internal sense of oppression. That's what I'd say it is for actors. We are somehow treated like we're the least important person in the room.
And we used to be the most important. There were no directors. We directed ourselves. We had our own company.
But still, we weren't the most important in the room.
Way back then?
Well, we need to come back to that. Now, you're going to have to connect me to all the places where I can, because that's going to help me with my mission, which is that we're the only person necessary to the theater. That we're
without
it. You know, we could shut Broadway down. We could shut it down. So contractually, the reality is, if we knew our worth, there's nothing they couldn't give us because they can't do it without us.
That's right. What do you know now that you wish you would have known when you started?
I think I'm just, in this point in my life, trusting my instincts. I wish I had more stronger instincts when I was starting out. But I didn't.
Why do you think that was?
I think that I grew up in a very chaotic household, so I was instinct injured. It may be why I'm a good actress, because there's that internal struggle all the time. But it definitely made for, you know, just being hard on myself. Well, I give this advice to any actress. First, I want to just say to you all something that I think is that has excited me in the last month. Check out a YouTube web series called Money and Violence. It's the most exciting thing I have seen in a long time. Money and Violence, it is a web series on YouTube. A guy, a non-theater or not, you know, didn't go to the conservatory guy, he bought a camera, he bought a $2,500 Canon camera. He bought an editing suite, Adobe Premiere. He watched some YouTube videos and he shot 26 weeks of a series last year. He put out an episode every week. They start off being 10 or 12 minutes. First of all, you're watching a learning curve that is, it's just so exciting to see somebody. He just did it. And he doesn't know the rules, so he breaks all the rules. He shot an entire series with one camera. He doesn't know about the line. It doesn't matter. He doesn't have any exposition. He doesn't have any backstory. You jump in, you meet people. And the beginning episodes are like 10 or 12 minutes. By the end, he's doing 45-minute episodes. But you see the story is all that matters. And, you know, you can make your own show on your cell phone. I mean, that's where the technology is right now. So first and foremost, I say to all actors, do not wait to be picked. Just do the work. Do the work, and people will find people who are doing the work and who are good. Merrily was so traumatic.
Traumatic.
Hal Prince and Stephen Sondheim were my idols, and ever since I was a little kid and had, you know, Company CD and listened to that, I dreamed that I should ever work with them, same as I dreamed of being on All My Children, because I watched it from the beginning when I was seven. And I have always had this kind of prescience about theater. I don't really know how to describe it, but even before we got there, people were like, oh my God, this is gonna be the biggest hit in the world. And I was like, we'll see. And I don't know where that came from, but I remember when I got in the room, his daughter was in the play. And so he was so concerned about taking care of us as the kids that I, in hindsight, I have to go, did they make certain decisions because they were always trying to protect us as the kids that didn't necessarily serve the play, like getting rid of all the hair and the makeup and the costumes and putting us in these t-shirts with letters on it. I don't know. I just know that everything that could possibly go wrong went wrong on Merrily We Roll Along. They fired, director, they didn't fire director, they fired choreographers, they lost all the hair, all the makeup. We lost set pieces. There was a swimming pool at one point. I mean, everything that could go wrong went wrong. And so thereafter, I was seasoned. Nothing that happened on any show ever was like, oh, really? Okay. That was nothing. So, yeah. I think that George C. Wolfe is as much a creator of that play as Tony and Janine. We always would say, oh, we shudder to see productions of this play afterwards.
Yeah.
When you are Black, there are things you know that other people just don't know. And for me, even Tony got things wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And so, but he was willing to go, oh, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Which is not always what you meet with. So for instance, Caroline was illiterate. Mm-hmm. As originally written. And George Siebel was like, my mother had two PhDs. We're not having an illiterate person.
Mm-hmm.
Just not having that. And Tony was like, okay. And he says that he believes there becomes a point in every show where the actors know more about the character than the writer. And so he trusts that. He's such an extraordinary writer, but he knows that if an actor is saying something they need or something's not working, you now know this character better than I do. And he listened to that. I'll tell you a funny story. Listen, it was sort of funny. The Lot's Wife, people may know this song, Lot's Wife. Mm-hmm. I sang it at the Tonys and it's sort of the 11 o'clock number.
Yep.
And it's not the original Lot's Wife. The original Lot's Wife is one of my favorite songs ever, ever, ever. And I know that they have a copy of it somewhere. And I think that they just won't let me have it. I can't find mine. Everybody, Tony keeps everything he wrote inside his watch. But everybody claims there is no copy in existence anywhere of the final version of Lot's Wife that we did before we started the actual production. At the Public. And so when I, all summer long, I'm singing this song for everybody and I'm like, oh my God, it's the greatest song ever, ever, ever. And when I come to rehearsal in the Public, it's not even in the script. Where that number goes is just blank pages. But I had such faith in Tony and Janine and George that I was like, okay. So one day they finally called a rehearsal to talk about this number. And I asked them, I said, so why is where's the Lot's Wife that we had? And they said, well, when you sang that song, the show had to end. Mm-hmm. We couldn't have any more show. Mm-hmm. And because Tony was committed to the children ending the show, they said, I said, so you've got to write a song that doesn't end the show. So that's what they did.
Oh, nobody could top it. Nobody could.
Right. They were like, we can't do anything after that.
No.
So. Yeah. The American theater is afraid to even look like America.
That's good. That's good.
So
that's the title of something.
Right. So, one of the things, I want to subtly get in if I get elected to council, which I have no idea if I will, is I want to plant the seed that I'd like every ensemble in every show on Broadway to be 50% peoples of color or differently abled people, so that what we see in the theater begins to reflect the world. I don't think we can change the world until the theater reflects the world, because I think that the revolution begins in the theater, that artists are the first people to pick it up and say it, and then the rest of the world picks up on it. So I feel, in the time that I have left, I want to work to make the theater look like America. It's very hard.
Mm-hmm.
It's very, very hard. I'm probably too honest and authentic, if I weren't as honest and authentic, I would probably be more successful. I was just with
you
a play.
You mean successful?
Yeah. I'd be more successful. Yeah. I just, like, you can't buy this thing that I do. It's not for sale. And I have, there are things that I know as an artist that I don't even know them as a human being. There are things I can do in my work that I can't, I don't have those skills in life. And so the vulnerability that it requires to do what I want to do means that it is often very difficult in the room. And I honestly would say, like, right now, coming off of the last two shows I did, I don't feel healthy. Like, when I went into the last two shows, I was in healthy, you know, had really been taking care of myself. But I find, for me, the challenge of being in rooms where people, where it feels to me like the emperor has no clothes, mm-hmm. and I'm clearly seeing what's going on and nobody's acknowledging it, that is soul murdering for me. Mm-hmm. Because it's the antithesis of how I come to work. So,
Do you write?
I do write, and I do direct, and yeah. I mean, at this particular point in time, I want to write the plays that I want to see,
yeah.
and like, I'm interested in a writer named Lucy Thurber, who
she's wonderful.
I love.
Just heard a reading of hers last month. She's just fantastic.
She's extraordinary, yeah. and when I saw Lucy Thurber's plays last summer, I was like, this mm-hmm. woman has written my life. Mm-hmm. How did this white woman from Appalachia mm-hmm. write my life? Like, that's my life mm-hmm. right there, mm-hmm. and so I've you know, developed a friendship with Lucy and talked to her a lot about it, and come to know that, you know, what white supremacy looks like is very specific and it's very narrow. And the people that Lucy comes from, they don't fit that. And so her plays don't get done. And she said, one of the reviewers at the time said, there are no white people like this. Because poor white people, they don't fit into the America that we're selling to the rest of the world. And yet she writes these plays that they don't look like what we're seeing on Broadway, but oh my God, they just touch me so, and there's so much truth in them. And, you know, yet again, she experiences the same thing I experience, because here, these poor white people, they are marginalized, and she says they come into their communities and they kill them and they harass them because they don't exist as well. So it's hard. And I, as I said, I don't feel healthy right now. Well, the best thing that I ever did to repair it, I mean, last year I did, I started Bikram. And I went like 76 days of Bikram. And okay. It's a yoga practice, hot yoga.
Oh, hot yoga.
And it gave me a kind of inner peace and a distance from everything, so that I was very open, but there was this center of peace that I had never, ever known. And I want to get back to it, but getting back to that heat is hard.
You know,
when you get to that heat, it is very, very hard. But that was something for me. And I certainly, you know, I keep an altar, and I, you know, I study metaphysical practices. I read a lot of history because I feel like I just don't know enough. And I'm always reaching out to find out what other people are going through, to know one that I'm not alone, and to find out how do you do it? That's actually the subject of a book I'm writing right now, which I'm tentatively calling Brown Skins, White Stages, talking about what is the experience of trying to be an artist inside of an institution that is putting forth a very specific idea of what white is, even. Yep. You know, that doesn't even include all white people. I guess I would say, if there was anything, I mean, it's a weird sort of thing, but being a mother was the most important thing to me in my life. I didn't start out to be an actress, so I always wanted to be a mother, so that was always my priority. And I remember when I was studying with Bill Esper, and I was pregnant with my son, and I, you know, when he was born, I would carry him on my snuggly and do my scene work with my son there, and he then grew up and is an actor and studied with Bill as well. I think that because that was my priority, I just trusted that work would come. I mean, one of the things Bill said to me is, you know, you're going to have this kid, it's going to take you out of the business for a while, and when you come back, you're not going to be able to catch up with people who are now going to have a whole bunch of credits and a whole bunch of relationships that you aren't going to have because of that time you were with your kids. And I was like, that's all true, and that's a chance I'm willing to take because being a mother is just that important to me. So I was fortunate that I had my first two kids and then got jelly. And then I had my next child and came out and got wild party, like, you know, nursing a baby, you know, had a couple more. And it just worked out that shows, you know, and I would think about it in the time between those shows, there was no show that I missed. That was the show I wanted to do. You know what I mean? There were jobs I missed. I mean, I turned down, you know, the doing Lady Tuptim and The King and I, and I didn't do Millie. But there weren't, you know, like great shows that I missed. And I have my kids. I have four kids.
Well, you've been so wonderful.
Thank you.
I'm so glad you
Thank you very much.